Good morning, everyone. This is Pastor Jim Harkabus from the Canyon Community Church of Lake California. Today, May 24th, 2020, we're having a drive-up service at the church, and we're so glad you could join us today. All right, good morning, everyone. We're starting our drive-up service this morning. We're glad each of you could be here as we are meeting at Lakehead, California, at the Canyon Community Church on Memorial Day weekend. It's a great day. It's a great time to get together to worship God, but also to remember those brave men and women who sacrificed, who died in service for our country. So we're going to pause and silently give thanks to them, and then we'll pray and we'll begin our service. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day which you have made. We thank you for the time to get together to worship you. Even in a drive-up service, we thank you for the technology that exists. We thank you, Lord, for the freedoms we have. And we thank you for those brave men and women who gave their all in service for our country, in the different wars, that we might have those freedoms today. The freedom of worship, the freedom of speech, the freedoms we have of due process. We thank you for our country. We do pray for our elected leaders for great wisdom. Father, as we worship you this morning, we just thank you for this day which you have made. Please glorify yourself, we ask, as we pay attentively to your holy word. And we just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, as we begin our drive-up service, we're going to we're continuing our series on from 2 Peter entitled Growing Strong in the Storms of Life. And as we begin our service, I have a question for you as we just prep your mind. If you were the Apostle Peter, and having walked with Jesus for 3.5 years during his earthly ministry when he walked this earth, and you experienced just about every single miracle that Jesus took place, what one event would you want to pass on to the next generation of believers? What one personal experience would you want it to be? Would it be Jesus' appearances after his resurrection from the dead? Would it be the feeding of the 5,000 or the 4,000 where he took two fishes and five small loaves and fed over 10,000 people with 12 baskets full of leftovers of fish and bread? Would it be the raising of Lazarus from the dead? And sitting down and talking with Lazarus that evening, after Lazarus had come back from being in the tomb for 4 days? Would it be the miracle of Jesus walking on water? And even walking along water alongside Jesus, as Jesus told Peter to get out of the boat and walk toward him, and he did. Would it be the calming of the stormy sea? Would it be the dramatic healing of the demoniac of Gadara? Or another event? What single experience would you want to pass on to the next generation of believers if you were in Peter's sandals? As you ponder that, we're going to have a song.
Thank you.
That's one of my favorite songs of all times. The Revelation song reminds of who Jesus really is today. Well, as you pondered my question, I hope you we're going to see why as we get dive in our passage this morning in 2 Peter chapter 1. As we in our passage in 2 Peter, Peter's going to reflect on obviously the greatest event that impacted him, and it's just simply amazing. As we approach the end of chapter 1 of 2 Peter, Peter is going to be affirming the importance of the Word of God, the written Word of God, the Bible, as the anchor to truth and reality in the storms of life. And many people are struggling because the Bible is not their anchor, it is not their rock, and that's why people are really struggling in the world today, amongst many reasons. We talked about the storms of life that the early church was going through in our series in 2 Peter. The same, very similar circumstances to some degree or another that the churches today is undergoing through. The church, early church, is being persecuted externally by civil authorities. They couldn't meet, they couldn't work. They just basically were sheltering in place, most times in the catacombs of Rome, in the sewers of Rome, to avoid arrest and persecution, torture and execution. But also their internal storms of life going on within the church at that time. Because there were false teachers that infiltrated the church, proclaiming that Jesus was not God in the flesh when he walked this earth, but he was just a man. And Jesus did not die on a cross, nor did he rise again bodily from the dead. And they was entering into the church and people were getting confused. And where Peter's going to be going with this, he says, the Word of God is the anchor. It is the solid rock on which we must understand, and even our emotional experiences must be subservient and fall in line with the written scripture. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 13 and 15, Peter reminded his readers that men will die, but God's word exists forever. As we saw and found out, that Peter is soon going to be passing, leaving the scene, but God's written word will last forever. Our next point Peter's going to make in his series in 2 Peter is this, that mountaintop or emotional experiences may occur, but they will fade, and especially in comparison to the certain word of God, which remains forever. And that's what Peter's going to be looking at. I'm going to be reading from the Bible, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 12 to 19. Please follow along your devices or just listen. You can research it later. 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning at verse 12. And God's word says, "Therefore, I will always be ready to remind you of these things, even though you already know them, have been established in the truth which is present with you. I consider it right, as long as I'm in this earthly dwelling, to stir you up by way of reminder, knowing that the laying aside of my earthly dwelling is imminent, which also the Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. And I will be diligent at that time. Anytime after my departure, you'll be able to recall these things to mind." Verse 16 through 19, our text for today. Verse 16, "For we did not follow cleverly devised tales when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and such an utterance as this was made by him, by the majestic glory, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.' And we ourselves heard this utterance made from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. And so we have the prophetic word made more sure, to which you do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star arises in your heart." May God bless his word this morning. The focus of this passage is going to be focused on the event which is referred to by Bible scholars known as the Mount of Transfiguration of the Lord Jesus Christ. This event was recorded in the Gospel of Matthew, the Gospel of Mark, and the Gospel of Luke, even though none of them were there. But Peter was there, and he's going to write about it. And we're going to look at the story. We're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 16, the last verse of chapter 16, and then it's going to spill over to Matthew chapter 17 of Matthew's Gospel. I'm reading again Matthew chapter 16, verse 28, through 17, verse 9. And the Bible says, Jesus is speaking, and he said, "Truly I say to you, there are some of those who are standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." Verse 1 of 17 says, "And 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, his brother, and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his garments became as white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, 'Lord, it's good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make 3 tabernacles here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah.' And while he was still speaking, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud said, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him.' And when the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground and were terrified. And Jesus came to them and touched them and said, 'Get up and do not be afraid.' And lifting their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. And as they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, 'Tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man has risen from the dead.'" Just a few comments on the passage in Matthew 17. This high mountain is unnamed. It was possibly the south ridge of Mount Hermon, which was about 12 miles northeast of Caesarea Philippi. It had a top elevation around 9,200 feet. It's a cold but breathtaking view looking south toward Galilee and toward the Sea of Galilee. And it says here, and we saw that in verse 2 of Matthew 17, he was transfigured. That's the interesting word. Where do we get our word metamorphosis? It means to change one form to another, to be changed, to be transfigured. And we still saw that Matthew noted that his face, Jesus' face, shone like the sun. And Mark notes that his garments became radiant and as white as no launderer on earth can make him, can whiten him. Sorry, OxiClean. This change about Jesus didn't come from without, but came from within. As Jesus' body was changed from human mortal flesh into, for a moment, into a glorified body. The Apostle John, who was also with Peter on the mountain, wrote of this later on of his experience. We're familiar with this in John chapter 1, verse 14. And John wrote, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. Glories of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth." And John's later letter in 1 John chapter 1, verse 5 says, "And this is the message you had from Him and announced to you, that God is light, and in Him there is no darkness at all." God is light, light so pure that's beyond description, so pure that even the sun would pale in comparison. And the disciples were blinded, as for a moment the glory of the incarnate God was unveiled to them. Even as Peter used these words, no doubt as he was writing his words in 2 Peter, no doubt he is playing this event back in his mind. It burned, it was etched in his soul, in his memory of the transfiguration of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we find, going back to 2 Peter 1:16, Peter writes, he says, "We did not follow cleverly devised tales when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." In other words, we didn't make this stuff up. This is not some scheme to make disciples. We are not making this stuff up. It's really, really, really happened. You see, the Roman and Greek cultures of that world abounded in myths and legends about the gods. And there's countless human speculations about the gods and what they're like and how the world came about. And you could write books on it. And in fact, the same issues goes on today. People kind of conjure what God is like in their own mind rather than see what He says from the Scripture. And people come to their own ideas of how the world came about instead of looking at the Scripture. But God's Word remains true. Amen? Amen. He says, "We did not follow cleverly devised tales. We made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." He says, "But we were eyewitnesses." We were there. We saw it happen of His majesty. And we, meaning Peter and James and John. Peter recalled what he saw and heard on that mountain. He saw the Lord Jesus Christ in His glory. See, when Jesus walked on this earth, His glory was hidden except in His miracles. But at the transfiguration, we see just for a moment the veil of His humanity drawn back and Christ in His glory revealed. Peter not only relates what he saw, and we're not going to really talk about Elijah and Moses. Moses represented the law. Elijah represented the prophets. And we'll talk about not to mind what they had to say. But he's going to focus on what he heard. Verse 17, 2 Peter 1:17 says, "When he heard, received glory and honor from God the Father, such an utterance as this was made to him by the majestic glory. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Folks, there's only three times in the New Testament that the voice of God the Father is heard. One was at His baptism. Second, here at the Mount of Transfiguration. And the third time was found in John chapter 12, where Jesus publicly presented Himself as the Messiah, as the promised Messiah to the people in Jerusalem. And again, going back to the Matthew 17 account, Jesus told the disciples, "Keep a lid on this. Don't tell anyone until after the Son of Man is raised from the dead." Can you imagine? Not other than talking about John and James and Peter, talking amongst themselves. What was this about? They couldn't even tell the other disciples. Simply amazing. Simply amazing. What do we learn from this event? The transfiguration of Jesus Christ affirmed that Jesus is indeed the Son of God, God come in the flesh. And folks, you know, the test of any religion, especially if we dive into chapter 2 and, And Peter's just going to call out by, he's going to describe a checklist how he can identify a false apostle, a false teacher by name. The question of any religion is this: what do you say about the person of Jesus Christ? Is he God come in the flesh? If you believe he's fully God come in the flesh when he walked on this earth, then it's from the Father. If he said anything else, it's a denial and they're apostate. I'm reading from 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 to 3. And God's word says once again, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they're from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. And by this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God, and every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you've heard is coming and is now already in the world." Very powerful stuff. We'll get more about that in the chapter 2. Secondly, the transfiguration of Jesus Christ explains what Jesus had come to do. He came not to be an example of how we ought to live, but to die for our sins and rise again. And that's what Moses and Elijah were talking about. Luke's account in Luke chapter 9 talked about the fact that they were talking about Jesus' departure that he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. They look forward to the cross. We look back upon the cross as New Testament saints. But my beloved, is the cross of Jesus Christ dying for our sins is the focal point of history at this point in time. Excuse me. The transfiguration of Jesus Christ is also an affirmation of the truth of God's word concerning God's coming kingdom. In this experience, we see Old Testament people of faith represented by Moses and Elijah. Moses represented the law. Elijah represented the prophets. And New Testament people of faith, Peter, James, and John, stand together with the glorified Jesus Christ. Truly a glimpse of the future, folks, and a picture of God's coming kingdom. And there's coming a day you'll be able to sit down and talk with Moses. You can down and have a chat with Elijah and all the Old Testament saints. And what a day that will be. And it's coming soon. Amen? Amen. So 2 Peter 1:19 says, Peter concludes, he says, "So we have the prophetic word made more sure, to which you do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star arises in your hearts." We have the prophetic word made more sure. What does he mean by that? Peter is saying that the written scripture is more sure. In fact, the Mount of Transfiguration is just an affirmation of the truthfulness and the accuracy of the Word of God. Because remember, Jesus said, some of you will not taste death before you experience the kingdom. And they did. They saw the picture, a glimpse of the coming kingdom. Kenneth Weiss, Bible scholar, paraphrases this verse. He says, "We have the scriptures that have a more sure foundation than even the signs of wonders which we have seen." That's a good way of catching it. People are putting great value on signs and wonders and experiences. My friend, it's the Word of God that we need to be focused on. It's the prophetic written word of Scripture that we do well to pay attention as a lamp shining in a dark place. Talk about shining in a dark place. Peter's talking about the world around him and the world around us and of the growing spiritual darkness that is pervading. Our world is engulfed in a growing spiritual darkness filled with deception and confusion. But as the world gets darker, the written Word of God is a powerful light to those in darkness. And again, going back to our lighthouse theme, as a lighthouse shining brightly on a dark, dark, stormy sea to guide people safely to heaven. Folks, and people's lives are being changed and lives transformed as they hear and read God's written Word. I share a story. It was written years ago. It occurred years ago, probably around the 1900 or so. And it's a story of an English diamond merchant. He was packing some gems up that he was sending to a trader in India. And he wrapped each of the diamonds separately with great care. But coming to the last and the most expensive of them all, I guess he ran out of paper. For whatever reason, he wrapped, he used the first three chapters of the Gospel of John, the paper of the Bible, to wrap this jewel in, to send it to this trader back in India. Well, the receiver of that gem, a man in India who was a Hindu faith, when he received it, was definitely discovered that the paper was far more of infinite value than the jewel, the gem, or the diamond he received. Because he read the words, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whoever believes in him should have everlasting life." The man was astounded. He spoke to many about his find and constantly inquired, says, why did I not know about this before, that God so loved the world to give his only Son? And the word of God grew in his heart. He was transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit. He said, "Surely this means me, the salvation is for me." By faith he accepted it, and his life was changed. And when later on, when a missionary from Europe went to that place, expecting to find no one who had heard the gospel, he found a large gathering of Indian Christians, people from India who had believed in Jesus Christ as your Savior. Beloved, the Word of God is what changes lives, not experiences. It's the Word of God, the written Word of God. So to summarize, Peter is saying, until Jesus Christ comes again in glory, we are to pay close attention to the written Word of God, the Bible. Why? One, because while men die and leave the scene, God's written Word, the Bible, lasts forever. Two, mountaintop emotional experiences may fade. They might be impressive, but they may fade. But God's Word, the Bible, remains forever true. Thirdly, as the world grows dark spiritually, God's Word, the Bible, and His message of truth shines brightly out into the dark, stormy seas of life, guiding people safely to heaven. At this time, we're going to pause and we're going to have a song. Another great song, isn't it? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, and we thank you for the written word of God. And we thank you that we have the Bible in our own language we can read and understand. And so often we take it for granted, and truly, Lord, it is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Help us to pierce through and understand the craziness around us and the world around us and all the confusion and deception. It is truly a solid and sure foundation. Father, we thank you. We thank you for this time together. We look forward to meeting together again next week. And Father, we just, until then, may we be found walking in the light of your holy word. And we give you praise and we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.